In this tutorial, we'll create a dinosaur character. We'll cover some basic modeling and then go over a simple way that you can weight the vertices of your character, essentially telling what parts of your mesh should be affected by the joints. I'll also go over my lighting and texturing workflow, and I use additional software for this, but you can still apply a lot of the same principles to your current setup. Now, we have a lot of information to cover, so let's begin. We're going to start off with a cube in our scene, and we're going to change the scale around just a little bit. So in the Y and the Z position, we're going to go with 150 centimeters, and in the X position, let's go ahead and do 250. We'll split up our segments into three parts in the X, and then two in the Y and the Z. Now you'll notice that I have lines in my scene showing off the different segments. To get those to show up, just come down to Display and select Grout Shading with Lines. Another thing you could do is hit N on the keyboard and hit B to get Grout Shading lines as well. So now for our dinosaur, this is going to be the head of the dinosaur and this will be the tail. And then we have our four legs coming from these segments. Now one thing we want to do is we also want to add the shoulder blade and the hips around our loop. So we're going to make our cube editable. And then going into the polygon surface model, we're just going to select the front and the back legs on the left hand side. And we're going to pull up our inner extrude. So if you hit M on the keyboard, down at the bottom we have what's called extrude inner at W. So if we hit M and then W, we'll bring that menu up. Make sure your maximum angle is set up pretty high. Usually it's defaulted to 89 degrees. And we're just going to create an inner extrude right around here. Now, this won't make a whole lot of sense until we get into rigging, but it's very handy to have that inner extrude right there. We'll do the same thing to the other side, and since we already have our offset ready, we're just going to click Apply. And we'll select all four legs, pull up the extrude menu by hitting D on the keyboard, and you'll see that we have a maximum angle that we'll want to crank up. You can choose whatever you want, but we want it to be over 89 degrees. We'll select the bottom four polygons from our leg mesh, and we'll just extrude them out a couple times, about 50 centimeters, and that looks about right. Next we're going to create the head and the tail loops, so doing an inner extrude and then also a regular extrude. And for these guys we're going to go almost to 60 centimeters and we're going to duplicate this multiple times. So next we'll come up to the head. Actually, let's undo the head once. It might get a little too long. We'll pull up our inner extrude. Instead of going on the inside on our inner extrude, we're actually going to pull it and go on the outside. And we'll do a regular extrude, again, about 60 centimeters or so. There's no real certainty with the math. Just do whatever looks right. And then we'll pull this end of the snout down to shape the bridge of the nose. We'll put our nostrils here a little bit later. But for now, let's go ahead and put our eyes in. So doing an inner extrude and then a regular extrude. We'll extrude right into the mesh here. And we also want to add a jaw to our character. This will be the top of the head, and then we'll create a jaw that drops down. Now for rigging purposes, we don't want these to line up perfectly. Also, when we're going to do texturing or any other sort of modeling in the mouth to add teeth or a tongue or anything like that, it becomes a little bit difficult to create that with these right next to each other. So we're going to drop this down a little bit and pull it in, and we'll extrude the mouth one more time, and we're going to drop that down as well. So once we have that, let's go ahead and create the lips and the interior of the mouth. So selecting all the polygons on the inside of the mouth, we're going to go and do another inner extrude. Now your angle has to be at the maximum for this. And we'll do an inner extrude here. And we're going to do a regular extrude in here as well. Now you want this maximum angle to be up as high as well, because this is a sharp angle on the inside in here. So we'll drag that. And now we have created the interior of the mouth. Later on we'll add on some teeth, but that looks good for now. On the opposite end over here, we're going to scale down the tail a little bit. Let's actually add in another segment or two. And with our scale tool selected, T on the keyboard, we're going to enable soft selection. So what we also need to enable the preview for that as well. And so what this does is this selects all polygons around your mesh. It usually defaults to group. Now, group only selects the central area radius based on what you're selecting. So if you were to select a polygon over here, it just doesn't have as strong as of effectiveness if we had it set to all. So we're going to go ahead and change that to all. Increase the radius until it gets up to the base of the tail, maybe not quite as far. And we're going to scale this down. And now if we normally scale this, it's going to pull our segments in towards the end of the tail. And we don't want that to happen. We actually just want the tail to scale down in size. So we're going to disable X or hit X on the keyboard. And when we scale this down, all it's doing is shrinking the overall size of the tail. Now that we did that, the tail looks a little disproportional, so we're going to pull the tail out just a little bit. And for this, we will want X enabled. We'll also increase the distance just a touch and pull the tail out until it looks right. So that's pretty much the basic modeling there. We're going to duplicate our mesh by holding down Control and dragging it up there, and we'll hide the initial mesh. This allows us to have a backup in case we don't like what we do further down the road. So starting here, this is where it can get a little bit more difficult depending upon what version of Cinema that you have. I have the R16 Studio version, and so I have all these sculpting tools available at my disposal. They just make it a whole lot easier to model. If you don't have those sculpting tools, you can use the soft selection and morph things around that way, but it just becomes a little bit more difficult and not quite as user-friendly because you'll be constantly changing your radius and moving things around as well. Now, to see if you have these sculpting tools, if you come up here to your layout and select the sculpting tool option here, that's when you'll know you'll have it, and it'll pull up this menu right here, and it has all the tools selected right here. Now, one thing that I did is I created my own startup menu with these tools in here. To do that, we're just going to go to Window, Customization, Customize Palettes. We're going to create a new palette, and then you'll just search for the different tools in here. You'll grab and pull over your pull. We also have grab, wax, and some of those other ones. It'd be handy just to go through that sculpting menu and write down the names of all of them that you want. I don't have all of them in my menu, I just have the ones that I use the most often. So once you have that saved there, you can click and drag on these little dots here and place it anywhere in your menu. And once you have it set up exactly the way you want it, we got to save that layout. So you go to Window, Customization, and save layout either as startup layout or as a special layout that you would choose. Just type it down there, and whatever name you have there will show up in this window. But for now, I'm just going to go back to my default layout, and here we go. So one thing we're going to do is we're going to drop this into a subdivision surface just to see how our mesh gets handled when it subdivides up and smooths out. Most of the areas look fine, but the area around the eyes, the mouth, and the feet look a little bit strange. So we're going to do a few more adjustments to our mesh. So selecting the four, and we also want to make sure we disable soft selection. We're going to select the four bottom feet pads, and we're going to do an inner extrude. And what this does is it creates a sharper corner for the subdivision to smooth out. So it doesn't smooth out quite as dramatically as it normally does. we're going to do the same thing with the mouth, but we're going to do that with the line tool. So in our line mode, we're just going to do a loop select of the interior of the mouth and exterior if we can select it. We're going to go to our bevel, which is M, then S on the keyboard, and we're going to create a small little bevel right around the lips. And actually, we're going to enable subdivision surface to give you a good look at what this is doing. So we're just going to create a nice sharp surface by having that selected. And we're going to also, I think, bring this in a little bit. So selecting our inner mouth along with our bevel, if you hold down U on the keyboard and then Y to grow the selection, we're going to scale this in just a little bit. And that'll give us a little bit more definition in the mouth. Another thing we could alternatively do is do a loop select on the inside of the mouth here and do another bevel on the inside. And that'll give us some nice topology, nice clean geometry inside the mouth. So from there, we're going to select our subdivision surface, drop it down to one subdivision. I will duplicate that because I think I really like that, and we'll hide our initial one. We'll make our subdivision editable, and we'll rename this to Dino. So now using the sculpt tools, we can use these either in our polygon mode or just our regular object mode. And we're going to just shape this dinosaur so that it looks a little bit more like an actual dinosaur. One thing I have enabled is the symmetry. And so I have the symmetry applied to the Z-axis, so it's applying on both sides of my dinosaur. That just allows me to have a mesh that is the same on both sides. We can add a little bit of characteristics to one side at the end if we want to, but for now we're going to try to make it as symmetrical as possible. I also have link symmetry selected so that if I choose a different tool, my symmetry settings before remain the same. So if I make a change in my smooth and want to smooth out the Y and the Z, and then I come back to my grab tool, that remains enabled as well. So we're just going to reshape our dinosaur, and at this point I like to have my different modes enabled. So clicking that little icon in the upper right hand corner of your viewport allows you to change the mode so you can see it from all different angles. This also allows you to edit a little bit more strict. So if you're dragging from here, and I think I'm dragging mostly up, but then it comes out to the side a little bit, this just allows me to create it directly straight up. So we're going to make the shoulder joints a lot bigger. Same thing with the hips. We're just going to increase the size quite a bit. And we're going to pull it out a little as well. We can also change the view. I believe it's left that we want here. I don't know if I'll be able to select it or not. And pull out the shoulders there. I don't think we'll be able to get the hips. Maybe if we change the camera angle to the right. Not quite, not as much as I would like. So a lot of this is just mostly experimenting, finding out what you like, what you don't like. One thing I noticed right now is that the neck looks a little too big and out of proportion. So we're going to go back to our polygon mode, and we're going to loop select, hitting U and then L on the keyboard. We're going to loop select the base of the neck and then the top of the neck, and we're going to scale that down. So with scale selected, one more thing, is we'll want to do a fill selection. So with U selected, we're going to hit F on the keyboard, and that'll allow us to select a filled portion from where we had selected. So if we have a closed loop over here, we can select the different sections. Holding down Shift, we're able to select both our loop selections before along with our new fill selection. So with the scale selected, we're going to make sure the X is disabled and scale down the neck a little bit. Now it's creating a little bit of undesirable results there. Let's turn on soft selection, decrease the distance quite a bit though, and we're going to bring that down like that. We can fix it a little bit with our sculpting tools, but for now that looks great. We're also going to shrink the size of the head down. So with the loop selection here at the base of the neck, we're going to then do a fill selection, but without holding shift, we're just going to click on the head and we'll scale down the head as well and center that back in place. So with our sculpting tools, we'll just smooth out the neck. It's not looking too great. There we go, that's better. So from there, we're going to subdivide one more time, and that should be pretty much it that we'll need for our mesh. Anything, any extra detail that we want to add, we can probably do with textures. So we're going to come up and do mesh, commands, subdivide, and then we're going to make sure smooth subdivision is selected, and then do a little bit more detail in here. For one, we're going to come up to our inflate settings. We're going to add a little bit of some eye folds here. And we're also going to change the characteristic of the head. So create this nasal passage here. And if you have any of these tools selected at any point you need to smooth out, you can hold down shift and use it as a smoother. It takes the pressure from your smooth. So if you had your pressure set up real high, it'll grab from that setting when you try smoothing, but it'll keep the size of the tool that you currently have. And let's round out these eyes a little bit more. One thing that becomes difficult as you're creating this really long mesh is that sometimes navigating around is not the easiest, so we can just change our navigation depending upon our mesh, and instead of the camera mode around the object, which the center of our object is right here, we're going to have our camera mode be around the cursor. So then as we're moving around, our camera moves its axis around our cursor. And let's inflate the lips a little bit. Not a ton, just enough to add some depth to them. And we'll use the pull tool just to pull out a little extra detail in the front. If it's a little too much, we'll smooth it out. And we'll pull out the cheeks a little bit. So let's go ahead and add the teeth. So coming back to our polygon mode, we're going to do a loop selection if we can. Not quite sure it'll work or how far we can get it. It looks like we can select right about here. So then we're going to come into our mesh commands and we're going to split. We're going to split this from our regular mesh. And then it creates a second object for with our split polygon. So we're going to rename this teeth. And actually, I don't quite like that, so we're going to redo that. We're going to do we're going to deselect the bottom row of teeth. Actually, that looks good there. If we deselect those two, that I think that'll work. So we'll come up back up, mesh commands, split. Come back down to the mesh, select all of them, and we're going to extrude them. Now, one thing we'll want to make sure for this extrusion is that we'll want to create some caps. We'll rename these teeth. And with our options selected, our extrude selected, we're going to make sure that we have caps selected. So this will allow us to create ends to our mesh. Otherwise, it would just create this empty hole in here, and we don't want that. Now we can come back and we're going to make some changes to the teeth, but for an easy way of editing these, let's go ahead and make a selection. So with the bottom of the teeth selected, we'll come in here and we'll choose select and then set selection. That way we have the rows selected for easy selection. And with our loop tool selected, we're going to deselect the bottom row and we're just going to fine tune the teeth a little bit. We'll grab a rotate tool and we'll drag the teeth down a little more and then maybe grab the front row teeth, holding down control to deselect those and then using a fill selection to deselect those fills in there. So then we just have the front of the teeth. And let's enable a soft selection but make it really weak. Maybe that was too weak. And we'll do the same with the bottom teeth. So just double click on our selection again. Deselect the top row. And then we'll loop deselect a couple of these polygons. And then we'll fill select just this one here. And with our soft selection enabled, we'll bring it back up. And that'll look about right. We can tweak those a little bit later, but for now, that's how I usually create teeth. Now for the eyes are fairly simple. I'm gonna pull up an arc spline here. And we're gonna throw that into a lathe right away. And we'll rotate this lathe 90 degrees. And from there, instead of having just a regular arc, we're going to change it to the segment mode. And we're going to, let's see, we're going to decrease our start angle. Let's try something like 30 degrees. So now we have the white part of the eye. And just, let's keep them this big for a little while longer. So now with that selected, we're going to put it in a null object. So hold down Alt-G to throw it in a null. And if you have the bevel deformer, we're going to throw that into our null. Now that adds a bevel to absolutely everything. We're just going to choose a sharp, or we're going to choose angle and have it just add a bevel to the corner there and increase that bevel. We can also limit it so that if our angle gets too sharp, that it doesn't go past beyond what we want. So we'll limit that, but we'll bring it down. And we'll add a couple subdivisions to it. So now we have this nice rounded edge around there. We're going to duplicate our lathe to create the iris. And so in our, we already have our start angle set exactly where we want it, but let's bring down the end angle and bring it on the inside. And there we go, there's the iris. And then finally for the pupil, what we're gonna do is we're gonna change up our angle to an arc. And we'll pull this out just a little bit so that we can see what we're doing. We'll grab our arc, and instead of the start angle, let's bring that down to negative 90. And actually, Yeah, there we go. Negative 90. And actually, I want this on ring, not arc. And we'll increase the radius. And we'll bring that in. And now we're just going to scale it down a little bit. Or maybe change up the... Yeah, let's do that. Let's change up the end angle and bring that down. Now we'll take that object and we're going to throw it into a symmetry object. And we'll just grab our eyeball, pull it out a little bit more. Well, let's see, I believe it's XZ. There we go. We want this in XZ mode. And we're not going to weld points at all. And from here, we'll just scale down our eyeballs. Grab our symmetry object and then place our symmetry object about where we want it. It's important to grab the symmetry object and not the null when we're placing it, at least on the x-axis. Scale them down a little bit more. And there we go. Now we have our eyeballs. We'll go into texturing a little bit more, but that just sets us up for success in the future. We'll do some final tweaks to the dinosaur, smoothing out a few areas, but it's almost to the point of rigging. So let's go ahead and make this these front legs a little bigger, especially the feet. Let's go ahead and grab an inflate object, increase that. Same with the back legs. And there we go. We've got our dinosaur. So now let's start the process of the rigging. One thing I forgot to do is actually add the nostrils. So let's do that real quick. Coming into our dinosaur, and we'll select the same polygons on both sides. And let's just double check, make sure we have the same on both sides. So if we select select our object, come over to the basic and click on X-ray, that allows us to see there. Or we can alternatively come in here and see if we have any additional selected in our opposing views. So now we have the same polygons. We're going to disable X-ray and we'll do an inner extrude. Drag that in a little bit and extrude it on the inside. We do have our caps on from our previous use, and we're just going to drag that in and then soften it up a little bit. So we'll just take our grab tool and we'll round out these polygons, and then we'll hold down shift and just apply a little bit of softness, and let's just bring them in a little bit more. We'll inflate just around the edges a tiny bit. And there we go. Let's start the process of rigging. So we're going to start off, and I actually have a special menu just for my character rigging right here. Essentially, all it is just coming to the character menu, and I have the weights manager right here in this window, and then I do still have my sculpting tools, and then I have some of these tools right in this menu right here, just for easier access. Another thing you could do is just click and drag this palette here so that you have it nice and handy. So we're going to grab a joint, and one of the things that I like to do is I like to start off with the hips of my character because they tend to move the least, or they're the central part to most of my characters. So with that selected, I also have all my windows open. That allows me to see if my joints are centerized on my mesh. So with the joint selected, we're just going to hold down Control and drop it into our previous joint. And we'll just drag that forward partway through the chest. I'm thinking right about there. We're going to drop another one and have a secondary chest joint. And this one will go right before the base of the neck. One thing that I'm looking for is where these polygons in the neck are starting to straighten out. And we'll have it end right there. So let's start off with the neck by creating another joint. And we're going to pull this up. I'm thinking probably right around, let's see, 4 or 5 segments for each joint. We don't want this to be too large because then our object isn't moving perfectly, but we don't want it too small to increase the amount of work that we do for rigging. So right about there, let's actually go to 4 segments. We'll try that. So if we select multiple joints and then hold down Control and drop them down, now all we have to do is drag it out a little bit, and we just added 2 joints. And we'll add 2 more. Click and drag. Now this last joint, I want it to end right before the neck begins, so we're just going to scale it back a little bit. That will allow us to do a little bit more tweaking with the head and the neck if we need to animate it in a specific way. So from there, we'll just create one for the head, pull that all the way out to the end, and then we're going to create another one, but we're not going to drop it in the head. We're actually going to drop it to the base of the neck, and we're going to bring it back down to where the jaw starts, and we're going to drop this one into a null, and that will just allow us to have a little bit more control in certain areas. And then with that neck joint, we'll drop in another joint and drag that all the way down to the bottom here. So now we have the head all rigged up. Let's go start with the tail. So coming back here, we'll just name this neck for now. We'll drop in another joint, and we'll name this one tail. And we'll bring it to the back here, starting at, again, where these polygons are starting to flatten out. This loop is starting to flatten out. It's not quite as drastic as a curve as over here. It's flattening out a little bit. And we're going to drop this tail into a null. Then coming down into our tail, we'll drop in another joint. Again, we'll do it about 4 segments. And there we go. Now that we have the basic structure, we just have our legs left. So inside of the main, we'll just rename this one hip. All right, so let's go ahead and create our legs. So let's add in a joint. We'll bring it up. Let's start with the front left leg here. Make sure it's about center all the way around. Actually, I want to tweak this mesh a little bit, give just a tiny bit more shoulder. And there we go. So we'll drop that joint into, let's see, so we have this neck that's not quite neck. We have it at, this one is actually more of a chest. And let's see, that is more where our neck starts. So we'll select all of our joints in the neck. We'll come over to the basic and we'll call it neck. Now we don't want this awkward line coming from the joints here, so we're actually going to throw this into a null, and we'll move the null over just a little bit more. Drop down the joint, and for this one what we're going to do is we're going to bring this joint down to about where we start seeing this line flatten out here. We probably actually want it to be a little flatter than what it is, so we'll come into our line segment tool on our dinosaur, and we'll take a loop selection here, and we want to do this to both sides. And we're just going to take our scale tool and flatten that out. It doesn't quite need to be at 0%, but some a little bit closer than what it was. Now we'll see a little bit later why that might be more important to flatten out that line segment. It just makes for easier selections and better rigging. So from there, we'll just add in the final joint for the leg. And with the entire leg selected, we're going to use our mirror tool. Since we already created the placement of the leg on the one side, and since our object has symmetry to it, we're just going to mirror this leg over to the right side. So with our mirror tool selected, we're just going to come in here and make sure our origin and our coordinates are set to world, and we're going to set this to the z-axis, because this would be, we want to mirror on the z-axis here, and then we'll scroll down and click mirror there, and so now we have one on each side, and we're going to grab both of our legs here. We'll actually come in and we'll name these front, because these are our front legs, and then we can select the front one specifically and say these are right and these ones are the left. Now we'll select both of these, we'll go into our mirror settings one more time, and just to save us some time, we're going to mirror on the back side. So instead of the Z, we're going to change it to X, and we'll click mirror. And now these will need a little bit of extra placing help. We'll just grab them, let's see, there they are. Let's scale them out a little bit. Actually, let's scale the starting point of the hips out a little further, and then we'll come into our settings, grab the second joint in each hind leg, and we'll bring that back in. Instead of having these labeled as front, we'll come into our naming settings and change it to back. And there we go. So now that we have the skeletal structure of our dinosaur, we need to get into the actual rigging. One last step that we're going to take right before that, though, is we're just going to add a num value to the ends of all of our joints, so it makes it a little bit easier to recognize them. So coming into our tools, we're going to go down and select the naming tool, and we'll select all the front joints here. And then if you ever happen to change selection, actually, let's go ahead and just lock this menu here so that doesn't change on us. But if you ever happen to select something and this menu changes, you can double tap the space bar to go to that tool as well. So with that selected, we're just going to add a suffix of period dollar sign n. And so the period just adds another period. The dollar sign n just looks through this whole list and adds a number. Actually, we're not going to grab the null for that. We'll just add the number to our joints. We'll replace name and then do the same for all of our joints. Actually, this one's our head, I believe. So let's rename this to head. And this one would be our jaw. So there we can unlock the setting, and now we will start rigging. To connect the bones of our dinosaur up to the flesh of our dinosaur, we're going to select the top joint up here and scroll all the way down to the last one in the list, and we're also going to control select our dinosaur. And coming into the character menu, we're going to go to the commands, and instead of just clicking bind, we're going to select this little setting, make sure allow null bones is unchecked and that joints only is selected. Once we click that, now we have Cinema's auto weight system. Now, the auto weight system is nice in many ways, but the problem is that sometimes it's not always completely accurate. If you'll see that it has, it's focusing mostly by distance and not actual surface area radius. What that means is this back joint is actually affecting areas of the mesh that it shouldn't. Other parts of the mesh work out fine, like the neck, but again, the head and then the jaw have a little bit of issues with the weighting surface, especially the jaw, since we only want the jaw to select the bottom part of the faces. So what we're going to do is we're actually going to select all of our joints here. We're going to come up and choose erase from the menu, and we're going to apply all. Now what that does is it erases the weight from everything in our mesh, and we're going to start from scratch. This may be intimidating, but it's actually a lot more simple than what you think, especially when we created our mesh with clean geometry. So let's start off with the neck joints. So we'll come down here to the neck. And with our dinosaur selected, we're going to come into our polygon mode. And we're just going to do a loop select at the front part. And let's make sure our neck is, again, selected in our weights manager. And we're going to loop select where this joint ends. And we can do a fill selection on the inside holding down shift so that we have this whole area selected. From up here, we're going to choose add and set the strength to 100%. And we're going to apply. Then we'll select the next item in our neck joint. Again, select all the polygons that it pertains to, and then click apply. Do another couple loop selections, and then a fill selection. Select the next joint and apply. And we're just going to keep going down the list until we have all of these selected. So then for the head, that'll be a little bit more different than what we've been doing, we need to make sure that it's only selecting everything from this part of the mesh on up. So it's going to be a little bit tricky. We're going to do a few different loop selections, fill selections, and deselecting certain polygons so that it gets the right ones that we want. So we want it to be these two right in here, and then we're just going to also select the base of the head. And we'll grab a fill selection to select those parts and then the upper part of the mouth as well. So once we have that selected, we'll just click apply, and then we'll do a fill selection and grab the bottom of the mouth, and we'll come down to the joint and click apply as well. So if we hold down shift and select all of our neck joints, that's what we've got so far. Next, we'll work on the tail. So coming down to the tail here, again, we're just going to repeat the same process that we have been doing. Make sure we don't have any selected up there. We'll do a loop selection at the base of the tail. Actually, I want to make sure that we're not running into the leg there. We'll grab one at the base of the tail and then fill that in. Oh, and I made a mistake up here. So let's undo that. Let's make sure those vertices aren't colored. We'll go down to the tail joint and we'll click apply. And for our final one, we just do a fill selection, grab that joint, and apply. Now, earlier we talked about having these nice loops around the shoulder, and here's really where that helps. When we want to add weight to our shoulder and leg joints, this really allows us to quickly select polygons instead of having to manually select them or paint them on. So we're just going to manually select those polygons, do a fill selection, and then with our front left leg selected, we'll click apply, and then do a fill selection at the bottom, select the second joint, and click apply. Do the same thing for the front right. We're going to do the loop select on the outside, on the outermost loop joint, making sure that there's no other loop joints there that we can select, so that's the outermost loop joint there. And this process actually goes a lot quicker than what you might expect, especially if you don't have to paint on the individual vertices. By having clean geometry, we're able to quickly speed through this process. Actually, here's a point where we forgot earlier to flatten out that loop. So we have a little bit of problem, but I think we'll be fine if we just have it selected here. And there we go. Let's just go ahead and select everything. Now the last part that we have is the chest and the hips. So these can be a little bit tricky to paint on if you're not quite sure exactly to select. We don't quite have too many loop selections that might make this real simple. But what we're going to do is we're just going to select some of these other areas. So we'll grab the area. Now there's this area where it's fading into the black. We want to make sure that we're selecting this, but because of the nature of our selection, we're actually going to grab where it's fully a different color on all of these. And we'll see in just a second why we're doing that. So next what we're going to do is we're going to do a fill selection. So instead of holding down control and selecting everything, we're just going to click. And that's what we got there. So now we have the chest and the hip selected. We're actually going to, let's just set selection. So we're going to come up here in our select menu, do set selection. We'll take a loop selection. We're going to deselect probably right about here. And we're also going to deselect a fill from the front. So this will be the hip section. So we'll select our hip and click apply. And then we'll double click on our selection up here. We'll go to our chest. We'll unselect the back part of it. And we'll click apply there. And so with everything selected, now you'll see that we have our dinosaur completely rigged. One problem that we will have, though, is as we start moving our dinosaur mesh, you're going to notice a little bit more stretching of the polys. It's really harsh. And we don't want it to be harsh. We want it to have a nice smooth transition like a natural skin would. So all we have to do is just grab all of our joints here and change our mode to smooth, and we're going to have it the strength set to 100, and we're going to apply this maybe 10 to 12 times. So what that will do is it'll smooth out the overall influence that each joint has over a particular area. So if we select this front left leg again, it is influencing the area to a greater measure, but it's not influencing areas that it shouldn't. Like before, we had that back leg affecting this joint here. And so this really just helps us to control exactly what we're looking for. So let's grab our front left leg and let's just rotate. What I like to do is just change all the rotations from my object just to see if it's behaving properly or if there's an area that I need to fix. An easy way to see if the tail is working is we're just going to select all the tail items. We'll come into our coordinates and we'll change the parameter here. So what I'm looking for is making sure that there's no pinching going on, that everything looks nice and smooth, and it's actually looking pretty great. I will do the same thing to the neck. And what you'll see here is that our neck is actually moving without the eyes and the teeth. So we'll just reset that. And we're going to come in and take our eyes and we'll move them into right underneath the head joint. Same thing with the teeth. We'll just grab and drop those in the teeth joint. We probably should separate these two objects into their own. So we'll just select it all, grab our tools, our mesh commands, split, and then we'll delete them from this mesh. Now next we'll want to make sure that we delete the points from this mesh. You'll see that they still have some existing points here. So if we go into select all the points and then do mesh commands and optimize, that'll get rid of those extra points. And then for the bottom teeth there, we're going to drop the bottom teeth into the jaw. So then as the jaw moves, the bottom row of teeth move with it. Look at that, we got that nice and smooth. Oh, maybe not there. And so now when we move the neck joints, the eyes and the teeth should go with. So we'll just scroll down here to the dinosaur. We'll select our weight manager and we'll click reset bind pose. That just puts everything back to normal. Now let's say you happen to have your dinosaur. We'll go back to our regular menu here. Let's say you have your dinosaur all set, but then you realize you bring him into a scene and let's bring in like a cone for like a tree. And let's say the rest of your scene is a lot smaller than your dinosaur. One way that you can scale down your rig is by selecting all the joints along with your dinosaur. Now we're going to take the skin object and we're going to disable the skin object for now. We're going to come into, instead of our model mode, we're going to go into our object mode. And then we'll select our scale tool and we'll scale down our dinosaur. And when we're finished, we'll go back to model mode and then we'll re-enable the skin right there. If you don't do that, what will happen is if you just grabbed your scale object and pulled everything down with the skin enabled, you get this weird result. Even if you disable the skin object, scale it down, and then re-enable the skin object, you get a weird result. So you always want to make sure that you have it selected to object mode when you're scaling your characters. So that concludes the rigging for your character. Next, we're going to get into the UV layout, and that'll help us to create some nice clean textures. And we will be using other software outside of Cinema. You can do it inside of Cinema, but it's just not quite as intuitive and easy as some of these other softwares. So we'll talk a little bit about that, and then we'll dive into texturing in the next tutorial.